Hi everyone, I hope you can hear me well. Just want to thank everyone for attending our series of talks on neurodiversity and disability equality. So today we have Dr David Simmons, who's going to present his work on perception and sensory processing in autism and how this can be affected within higher educational settings, but more so in an academic sense. So it'll cover sort of student settings and how we could relate to staff work settings too. So a bit of background on David. He's the collaborator of the ISSF Neurodiversity Project that I lead, but is definitely more of a team member, I would say. So David has spent most of his academic career researching visual perception. However, in recent years, his research interests have broadened to include visual aesthetics, visual appearance, synesthesia, and his current main focus, perception in autism. So David is passionate about increasing awareness of sensory stresses in leisure, work, educational environments, and is working with his large team of PhD students on a range of projects related to this theme. So without further ado, I will pass you over to David.
Thank you very much, Lee. So I will start to share my screen now. So hopefully you'll get to see my presentation, which I've now completely lost from my screen. So, oh no, this, there it is. And I'll share sound and optimize the video clip as well. So. Just give me a sec here. Right, is that clear for everyone? Great. Okay, so I'll talk today about sensory processing in autism and how that's affected within higher education settings. So you've got my Twitter details there if you want to follow me on Twitter. I mainly tweet about perception and autism, and there's also my email address too. So this is an outline of the talk. So what I'll do is start with what autism is, just very briefly, then spend most of my time talking about the sensory issues and how they what these sensory issues are. And then in a briefer section, talk about how they might be complications in higher education settings. I'll finish by what can be done, how these apply in other neurodivergent conditions, and some final thoughts. So I hope that's okay. Just a few preliminaries. When I say autism, what I mean is all these things. So autism spectrum disorder is the formal clinical diagnosis under the DSM-5, which is the current diagnostic criteria. But we also have, under older diagnostic criteria, childhood autism or autistic disorder, Asperger's syndrome or disorder, atypical autism or PDD-NOS, autis, aspies, and even self-identified autistics. That's the qualification there is obviously some people who identify as autistic might not be. But nevertheless, many of the same things will apply to them. In terms of terminology, I'll try to be very careful and reflect autistic community consensus and primarily use identity-first language. So talk about autistics and autistic people, as is usually preferred by most of the autistic community. I shall try to avoid person-first language. That's people with autism. Obviously, sometimes in quotes from older papers that won't necessarily apply. Although some people still prefer that person first terminology, but I'll reflect autistic community consensus and use identity first language. Now, the first thing I always say in talks about autism is I've christened this Simmons rule number one in the hope to get my name somewhere. Everything to do with autism is controversial. Okay, so there are bound to be people that disagree with some of the things that I say. many aspects of the field are controversial. So just bear that in mind as we go through the material of this talk. So very briefly, autism is a neurodevelopmental condition. So we think it's present from birth, which results in neurodiversity in brain structure and function. And it was first formally described in the 1940s. And it seems to have a large genetic component. So it's about just over 50% heritability, so passed on from parents to children, which means it's not all about genes, but there's a strong genetic component. The prevalence in the UK is about 1% as currently diagnosed. That comes from a meta-analysis done by the Scottish Government a few years ago. But I do emphasize as currently diagnosed because one of the features of current diagnostic techniques is it's autism spectrum disorder is more common in males, but it may be poorly diagnosed in females. So there probably are more females with autism than more autistic females, I should say, than we currently have on the books because it's not being diagnosed properly. So just bear that in mind. But that's in a nutshell what autism is. Now, the thing is, there isn't a genetic test or a neuroscience test that you can do that definitely says this person is autistic. What you have to do is observe behavior. And this is a sort of cartoon from the National Autistic Society, which suggests the sorts of behaviors that might be indicative of autism. So it's really a series of behaviors that is then classified and compared to the diagnostic criteria by observing behavior. So that's briefly what autism is. What are the sensory issues? What is it that we're actually talking about? Well, when you look at this set of behaviors, that not many of them appear particularly sensory, you might say that I've lost my mouse. You might say that the eye contact, many people, if they don't know much about autism, they know there's a difficulty with eye contact. So eye contact is obviously something to do with vision. So there could be a sensory component to that. And this other one, handling or spinning objects, again, you've got vision, you might have touch as well involved with that, maybe even sound. So there's a little bit of sensory component there, but that doesn't really reflect what I'm talking about when I talk about sensory aspects of autism. So let me give you a very, before I give you that very concrete example, let me tell you how it tends to be subdivided. So we tend to talk about hypersensitivities and hyposensitivities. So in hypersensitivities, people are more sensitive than the rest of the population. This tends to have two flavors. One is defensiveness, so that's when you try to escape from or get away from unwelcome sensory stimulation. And the other one is enhanced perceptual functioning. That's when you can detect things that other people don't appear to be able to detect, or you notice things that other people don't notice. So those are the two sort of facets of hypersensitivity. Then we also have, and at the same time, hyposensitivity, where people are less sensitive than the rest of the population. And that again has two flavors. One of those is simple unresponsiveness, where maybe somebody calls your name and you don't respond to that, or you don't notice changes in temperature or pain. And the other one is sensory seeking behavior, which is where you actively seek out certain types of sensory stimulation. And one sort of set of thinking behind that is because of understimulation. You want to stimulate your sensory faculties. So those are the sort of, that's a general way that sensory issues in autism have been classified over the last 30, 40 years. Let me give you a very concrete example. And this is from a boy who I know particularly well. when he was about 6 years old. So in terms of his hearing, he was hypersensitive to noise, and that and there were particular noises that were bothersome, sort of explosive type noises, fireworks, balloons which pop, of course, dogs which bark, sirens and fire alarms, all sort of noises designed to attract attention, if you like. But despite this hypersensitivity, he failed diagnostic hearing tests, and there was a suspicion at one point that he was hearing impaired. So you have hyper and hyposensitivity in the same sense, which is really quite distinctive of autism. In vision, he was drawn to visual motion, in particular, you know, TV clips that had lots of motion in, like train crashes and car crashes and things. Possibly also flicker, and there would be some what's called self-stimulatory behavior when he would flick fingers in front of his eyes. Repetitive behaviors involved running up and down, which again would give visual stimulation, what we call in the trade optic flow. So that would suggest sort of hyposensitivity, sensory seeking behavior related to vision. But on the other hand, he was scared by sudden flashes of light, like flambéed food and lightning, and especially in things like that. In terms of taste and smell, he was a picky eater, so very choosy about the food that he ate, and had particular problems in fragrant chops. A good example would be Lush as a fragrant chop, if you know that chop. So that's one example. Let me show you another example. This is Temple Grandin.
When I was little and the school bell went off, it hurt my ears like a dentist drill. It was just absolutely terrible. Another kid may have visual sensitivities. These sensory problems are really variable. I mean, one way you can kind of figure out how severe the sensory sensitivities are is to ask what happens at Walmart. And if every time you go to Walmart, it's a screaming fit, then you've got very, very severe sensory problems. But it's variable. One kid's going to like running water. Another kid's going to go running away from it. But things like the smoke alarm are often the worst. My auditory threshold is normal. You go test the hearing, it's normal. But that tells you nothing about auditory detail, the ability to hear the hard consonant sounds. And these problems are inside the brain. We need to be doing a lot more research on the sensory issues, on the problems with hearing, because a lot of these sensory issues are very, very debilitating. You know, if you can't tolerate a normal store environment or an office environment, that really messes up your language. Now, some kids are echolalic and they're repeating back all these commercials. Why do they do that? They don't hear very well, so they tend to repeat back, sort of like repeating back a phone.
A phone book is the word that she was using at the end. And sorry, I should have muted my sound there so you didn't get background noise. Anyway, so that's Temple Grandin, the famous autistic academic. So that's adults. Now, in fact, we've known about these sensory aspects of autism for many years. In fact, the very first description of autism by Kanner in 1943 reports things in the 11 children that he talked about, reported food refusal, aversions to loud noises, aversions to affective touch. That's that sort of hugs and things like that sort of thing you tend to do with a child. Your own child, and there were examples of sensory seeking behavior, auditory hyposensitivity, and enhanced perceptual functioning, all in the very, very first description of autism. But when discussing sensory hypersensitivity, Kanner said this: yet it is not the noise or motion itself that is dreaded. The disturbance comes from the noise or motion that intrudes itself or threatens to intrude itself upon the child's aloneness. The child himself can happily make as much noise as any that he dreads and move objects about to his heart's desire. So Kanner thought that the whole issue with sensory disturbances came from other people invading the territory of the autistic person, not from the sensory stimulation itself, because when the child made the sounds themselves, they didn't respond in the same way. What we now know, and this will come out later on, is that was a misunderstanding of how the sensory mechanisms work, which isn't surprising, because in the 1940s, we didn't know anywhere near as much as we do now about the senses. So it took a while for this to come through. Up until 8 years ago, there were no explicit considerations of sensory aspects of autism in the diagnostic criteria. However, in 2013, the DSM-5 was published. And if you look at the DSM-5 diagnostic criteria, you'll see that under section B, which is restricted repetitive patterns of behavior, interests or activities, you see hyper or hypo-reactivity to sensory input or unusual interest in sensory aspects of the environment. So it's now in there as an optional inclusion. So it can contribute to an autism spectrum disorder diagnosis under DSM-5. There's a little bit more detail given if you read the full DSM-5. So they talk about unusual reactivity to sensory input, hyper or hypo-reactivity to sensory information, unusual reaction to sensory aspects of the environment, indifference to pain or illness, adverse reactions to specific sound or food textures, excessive smelling or touching of various objects or parts of people may be evidence as well. So those are the examples that are given in the formal diagnostic criteria from the American Psychiatric Association. So that's the formal side of it. How, if you're wanting to do research on this, how can you go about doing that? Well, one, this sort of summarizes the different approaches that have been taken in the past, and by far the majority of the work has been done on observer report. So this has largely been parents or caregivers talking about the sensory responses of their children. And one of the instruments you can use for that is the sensory profile. It's the most widely used instrument. It's been around since the late 90s. So you would fill that in on behalf of your child and then see how that mapped onto their actual behavior. But of course, that's not ideal because the parents themselves aren't experiencing these sensory issues. So you'd think that it would be much better to talk to people themselves. And we have, in the case of Temple Grandin and lots of the other books about autism, we have these autobiographical accounts. But of course, if they're in a book, you don't know the role of editors and things like that. So what we've focused on and what I'll focus on today is self-report. So when we talk to autistic people and ask them about what their sensory issues are. And I'm going to focus on two particular papers, one by Smith and Sharp, published in 2013, called Fascination and Isolation, a grounded theory explanation of unusual sensory experiences in adults with Asperger's syndrome, and our own paper with Ashley Robertson, who's also was my PhD student, now a lecturer in the School of Psychology and Neuroscience, The Sensory Experiences of Adults with Autism Spectrum Disorder, a Qualitative Analysis. That was published in 2015. So in the case of Smith and Sharp, they interviewed 9 autistic adults with a diagnosis at the time of Asperger's syndrome. They were mean age of 33, with a ranging from the 20s to the late 40s. Majority were male, but there were 3 females in their sample. And they used semi-structured interviews and instant messaging software. Whereas in our case, we had one focus group of 6 autistic adults, 5 of whom were male, but the average age is about the same as this sample. So I'm concentrating on the adult presentation of these sensory issues as the most relevant for the people, I hope, for the people looking at this talk. So in general, an overview of the data is that all participants report these negative and positive reactions to sensory stimuli. And I emphasize that you get positive as well as negative. The other themes were very strong emotional and physical reactions and the importance of control and predictability, which actually brings us back to that Kanner quote, but more of that later. So let's just have a look at some of these sensory experiences. And both Smith and Sharp and ourselves found that auditory issues were the paramount thing, as in the example I gave you before, as in what Temple Grandin talked about. So things like babies crying, sirens, dogs barking, fireworks, even in one case, birds tweeting were problematic. And it's associated with pain, it's associated with anger, and it's associated with fear. For example, one of the participants said, loud noise can bother me quite a lot and it can feel painful. Or another said, I find I dwell on each noise and it irritates me and I hear them very loudly. So those are actual quotes from those papers. There are also issues with light intensity and quality. So in some cases, this is around fluorescent lights. My eyes have struggled in sort of like fluorescent light or unnatural light. That sort of stimulus becomes painful after a while. So again, we see the pain coming through. Another participant said, I particularly dislike bright sunlight. I hate conservatories. The irritation it causes is maddening. So you've got artificial light, but it can be natural light. So it's not just restricted to that. Something that we picked up that Smith and Sharp didn't is this issue with grids and regular patterns. And people talked about, I have the experience still to this day of standing in a shop, staring at things for about 5 minutes. It's the kind of structure of the shelves and repeated things that becomes too much. And I just stop being able to process any of it. And another said, I have problems with maybe one of those mats with zillions of those metal strips, like the station. I think that's Central Station in Glasgow. It's like an optical illusion. And we also have issues with smell. So, for example, one of our participants in 2015 said they've got a new hand gel in the loo and I just couldn't use it because it was just so overpowering. Another said, the smell of food, I don't get used to it while I'm around it. So those are negative sensory experiences, but there are also positive things. In particular, music. One participant said, I like loud music and stuff like that really helps calm me down. What you might call mindful observation. I like to look closely at things and see the details. I enjoy using essential oils for scenting the air and massage. And another, this is one of our participants, said, talked about cold things like stone floors or metal, especially as a young child, but still now as well. I used to put my hand underneath chairs and stroke the metal bits on benches. So you could call this sensory seeking behavior, but it is pleasurable in these circumstances. But there are also these strong reactions. So just some quotes, bad smells feel quite painful as well. I always just assumed that's just how they are. Another participant said, if a fly came into my classroom, the buzzing goes through my head like a saw. I know that may seem an extreme of a description, but it feels like I'm being raped, like I'm being violated. And another person talks about anxiety reactions. You know, when bubbles come up uncontrollably, when you open a bottle of pop, that's what it feels like in pictures in my head. So these are very extreme reactions to sensory stimulation. But then this theme of control and predictability comes through, and there's this one great quote here that came from our focus group. One of the things I've noticed come up quite a lot is control for people, and that seems to matter. If they have control over the sensory input, then it's much less distressing. And I find that's quite true with touch. If it's a surprise, or if I don't feel control over it, for example, if somebody's bigger and stronger, then the touch is more unsettling than if we've got a feeling of control. So there are other examples of quotes in those papers. So just to summarize these qualitative studies, what came through very strongly is the debilitating effect of negative sensory experiences. People talked about nausea, pain, distraction, and confusion. And in some cases, there were attack or escape responses where you'd try to physically attack the person making the noise, potentially, or just run away. And the emotional discomfort this can cause, anxiety, distress, and irritability are the result of that. And obviously, it can clearly spoil the day of the person who's experiencing these things. And yet, on the other hand, there are these positive sensory experiences which are enjoyable, calming, and absorbing. So this contradictory nature of the way these sensory factors in autism work is really apparent in those two papers. Well, let's think specifically about higher education environments and how things might be affected there. The thing is, it strikes me that in higher education environments, you have lots of uncontrollable factors. There's the public, if you're thinking about going to and from campus, there's the public transport. There are lecture theatres themselves in which, and obviously if you're the lecturer, you are to a certain extent in control of the environment, but if you're a student, that isn't true. Food outlets are another issue, which I'll talk a little bit more about shortly, and social areas as well, sports facilities, where things are really not under your control as they would be in your own home domestic environment. Of course, a little bit different under lockdown conditions and since more of us are working at home. And the other thing is, of course, that stress levels are high. We have deadlines, there are social events, there are unfamiliar people and environments. So those two things together mean because stress and anxiety modulates the sensory issues, those are going to make things a little bit worse. So let's just focus on the food outlets and think about, I mean, this is a picture of the, I think that's the Fraser building. The angle looks strange to me now. But what you're going to have are high noise levels in those environments. And in fact, we didn't measure it in the canteen here, but in a primary school, we actually measured the noise level at 98 decibels in a canteen, which is equivalent to having a motorbike drive past you. The unpredictability, people are dropping things, you're dropping trays, you've got the clanking and sounds of coffee machines and cutlery on plates and things like that. You've got the smells of the food itself. Often you tend to have quite functional lighting, wouldn't you, in those places, so people can actually see the food, especially in the food sort of distribution area, where you've got these sort of health and safety considerations which come in. You have lots of motion around, so people are moving to and fro, and also food selectivity, one of the other aspects of autism. I've mentioned picky eating, but some of our participants in Smith and Sharps talked about this not having different foods next to each other and how that can be distressing. And obviously in a social situation, you might be self-conscious about that. So those food selectivity issues come into play, or maybe they don't have the food that you want. So food outlets are a particular issue, I think, in academic and higher education environments. This is a quote about sensory overload. So the idea of sensory overload is when all of these sensory factors just build up and build up, and you get something that's very close to although distinctively different, I'm told, from a panic attack. So this is one of our participants describing it. The job I had before this one was in an open plan office where they played five different radios in the same office. And then you would have people coming in and out. By the end of each day, I was literally sitting with my head on my desk. And there's lots of there's a phenomenon called autistic burnout that's receiving some attention these days, which is the idea of this having to simply lie down in a dark room to get over a big sensory day. So that's another factor. I should have given you a content warning for this. I took this photograph was at the front of the Fraser building. So that's one of those mats that our participants talked about. And that's actually on the University of Glasgow campus, or at least it was when I took this photo a couple of years ago. That's the sort of stripy pattern that we're talking about. Another issue that came up in some of the surveys we've done on campus is that signage can be problematic, and autistic individuals apparently rely more on maps and landmarks rather than instructions like arrows And we have quite a lot of arrows on our campus, although we do also have apps which help us navigate around campus now as well. So what can be done, or how can we ameliorate this sensory stress in higher education settings? Well, I guess you've got two choices. The first choice is to adapt the individual. So that's the work on it yourself. This is some data from a study we published in 2018, which wasn't specifically looking at autism, although we did have autistic participants. So in this case, the autistic participants would be the high scorers who are shown in green here. And what we asked them is how they coped with a sensory stress situation. And what you can see is that most of them, the majority of the autistic participants, actually went for avoidance. Nearly 40% of them said that. The other thing was sensory self-soothing, and I'll sort of explain what that is. It's sort of rocking or humming or something like that, rather than non-sensory self-soothing, which would be more sort of yoga type responses like deep breathing or centering. So avoidance does work, but obviously that's unsatisfactory, because if you avoid everything, that's going to increase your social isolation. And in some cases, if it's an extreme avoidance, that can be very dangerous. There's an example working with other participants where an autistic child was very scared of bagpipes and arrived at Glasgow Central Station and ran away because there was a bagpiper there across the busy street. But imagine if you're suddenly surprised by something, you could run away or jump into a busy road accidentally. So there are dangers involved in that. Now, there are lots of options to use these days, in particular headphones, earphones, ear defenders or ear plugs of some sort. It's much more socially acceptable than it used to be to walk down the street with a pair of headphones on. A lot of people will use phones as well if they're not moving around. But again, of course, if you're cut off from the rest of the world all the time, this can also result in social isolation. There's a little video I have, which I might play at the end, which is to do with a particular type of earplug which has recently come on the market, but I won't do that just now. Some approach, I've not really heard about sensory integration therapy being used with adults. It tends to be used with children, but this is a form of therapy which has a combination of elements using weighted vests or riding on scooter boards, throwing rings over cones and things like that. You have a personalized treatment program, but the efficacy of that is quite controversial and it's highly dependent on the therapist. So I don't think there's really brilliant evidence that works, although probably, as with many of these things, it works for some people and not for others. Something I've worked a little bit on, colored filters, which was originally put forward as a treatment for reading difficulties. And there is some evidence that it's effective in autism, although not necessarily to do with the sensory issues around autism. In the research that I was involved with Amanda Ludlow, we showed that it helped autistic children interpret social situations better than without without those colored filters. And there's a similar story for yoked prism glasses as well, which is an unproven sort of therapy, which some people say works very well. Another approach is progressive exposure therapy. And we know that this works quite well, at least in neurotypicals, for phobias. And there's some evidence that in phobia situations, some great research at University of Newcastle, Newcastle University, which has looked at this approach for phobias in autistic people. So the idea for this is you progressively expose individuals to particular stresses in a controlled way, And the way they did it at Newcastle was to use virtual reality, which of course is something that we're looking at. We're looking at virtual reality here to investigate perceptual aspects of autism as well. There's a couple of projects related to this that I worked on, a serious game related to auditory hypersensitivity and a virtual reality simulation of Aberdeen Airport. So in the serious games, this was with Glasgow School of Art, we developed a game called Sinbad and the Magic Cure. And it was my a student called Hanan Maki-Zakari who developed this. And in this game, you had to try and find a treasure, but that treasure was guarded by these unpredictable noises. And you could change the different levels of the game to make it more or less difficult for yourself. Unfortunately, Hanan sort of left to take up a lectureship elsewhere, and that's sort of where it stopped. We did try it out on a few people, but not much extensive data on that. But I think it's a good idea. And the other one, people at Glasgow School of Art working on this, and I wasn't a direct collaborator on this, although I was involved in overseeing the project, where, again, using virtual reality to simulate Aberdeen Airport. And the idea here is what you can do in a virtual reality simulation is you can increase the number of people in the environment, you can change the level of sensory stress and make it more or less difficult for people. So you can do this walkthrough of the airport and then maybe eventually get to use an aeroplane, which some autistic people find difficulty with, just getting through an airport because of all the noises and smells and lights and things like that. So that's one way of doing it. The other thing you can do is adapt the environment. This is sometimes recommended by occupational therapists, but it's controversial because you can't always adjust the real world. But it can be helpful in educational, domestic and workplace contexts, which really encapsulates the higher educational settings. One of the issues, though, is knowing what to adjust. And we developed a process for doing this called the sensory audit, which is a technique for measuring sensory stresses, which looks at the visual components like light levels, color and decor, the auditory components like the sound levels, the sound quality and the specific sounds that come up, and the ambient smells. And unfortunately for the ambient smells, it's quite hard because you have to just go around and sniff. To do that, there isn't an instrument you can use for that. And this is Sally Bell, one of my former students, who was measuring the color of the walls in her apartment and noting down that information. And also that's the sound level meter that we use to measure sound levels. Some observations from this, it's one of those projects that's been sitting on the back burner for a while, which we really should write up, but some common domestic noises can be surprisingly loud, like cupboard doors banging. In a more institutional context, this would be toilet doors, for example, banging. Smells are very hard to measure objectively, and that's why you have to sort of go around rating them by hand almost. You have to be very careful how you do that. Enclosed spaces can become very smelly. So what we found is lifts and changing rooms were particular areas, and obviously canteens are the biggest issue there, with the fridges, the food smells and noise from other users. Other particular places are corridors and transition points and reflective surfaces near windows, which can be visually disturbing. That's reminiscent of the conservatory situation that was mentioned already. There is some government advice on this, which actually I was involved with, the menu interventions, which was developed as part of the Scottish strategy for autism. Under sensory issues, the advice is we should perform assessment of sensory difficulties, identification and implementation of strategies and environmental adaptation on an individual basis with individual control towards reducing the impact of sensory sensitivity. So that's in official Scottish Government documentation. But of course, what happened with a lot of this stuff, it ended up being a guideline or recommendation rather than anything legally binding. So what it means in practice will vary between local authorities and different institutions. We also have Morrison's introduced this quiet hour, and a lot of other places are introducing these specific hours in which the light levels, sound levels are reduced and things like that. Although it tended to go away a bit during lockdown, I'm not sure to what extent that's been reintroduced more recently. This is my advice if you're in this situation. My advice is that knowledge is power. So be aware of your sensory issues. Try to learn what your stresses are and where and when they are likely to happen. If you do that, you can then develop strategies to cope, excuse me, with the expected and predictable stresses, and also think about how to cope with the unexpected or unpredictable stresses. If you do what you can to keep your anxiety levels down, this will reduce the impact of sensory stress. And we know that anxiety modulates sensory stress. The other thing that you can do, especially in a higher education environment, is develop a network of what I call havens. These are safe places you can go to when sensory stress levels are high. If you're staff, then hopefully your office will be like that. Although if it's an open plan office, it might not be. If you're a student, then maybe libraries, the chapel, other places. One place that came up in one of our surveys was actually the main building, that people just love the main building and like looking at it, especially the resemblance to Hogwarts is appealing to many people. And so the quads in the main building are also potentially a haven for some. Well, of course, they can get busy at some times of year. I should just mention before I'm nearly finished, some neurodivergent conditions other than autism. We developed something called the Glasgow Sensory Questionnaire a few years ago, which has been quite widely used. And this shows how your score in that questionnaire, which increases with the number and severity of your sensory difficult issues, not necessarily difficulties, how that changes with autistic trait level. And you can see as the autistic traits increase, the total sensory score increases. So a lot of these people, the autistic people up here, these people won't necessarily have an autism diagnosis. So they're not necessarily autistic, but they still report significant levels of sensory difficulty. So it applies to more than just autistic people. Synesthesia is this condition, rather interesting condition, where you often see numbers in colour or days of the week and things like that. And they can have other aspects to it as well, which we also do research on synesthesia. Synesthetes score higher on the Glasgow Sensory Questionnaire as well as autistic people and higher than controls. There's quite a lot. Many autistic people are also synesthetes, so that comes into it as well. But a recent study using our questionnaire, not done by us, but done by Panagiotidi and colleagues, showed that if you look at ADHD traits, you also score higher on the Glasgow Sensory Questionnaire. So the more ADHD traits you have, the higher you tend to score. And that's a similarly high correlation there. So the bottom line is that sensory issues, at least as measured by the Glasgow Sensory Questionnaire, are a factor in other neurodivergent conditions too, not just autism. My final thought, and I want to end on a positive note, it's not all doom and gloom. You should make the most of your unique perception of the world. The sensory features of neurodivergence can often be a source of extreme pleasure and the foundation for creativity in art, science, and scholarship. And, you know, often people say, well, I'm not necessarily a savant or anything like that. I'm not able to draw a picture of New York from memory like Stephen Wilshire. But there's a great quote here from the Smith and Sharp study. What made me a great chef was my determination to be the best and my passion for fair play, teamwork, as I can make flavors and textures of food just by seeing it and can know what fits with what and my oversensitive tastes. So I could know really what food tasted like. If you taste olive oil, you may just taste the oil. I can taste the olive and other fruit oils used to make it. So that was somebody, or an autistic person, using their enhanced sense of taste and smell, of flavor, to contribute to their career. And there's lots of other examples of that around and in the literature. I recently heard, for example, that the British composer Malcolm Arnold was probably autistic, and what amazing achievements he had, although a very difficult life, what amazing music he wrote. An example from the most recent past is Lizzie in Bake Off, who sort of came out as neurodivergent in the last episode of the series and made this incredible cake to celebrate neurodiversity. So I think that's a good point on which to end. And I was just going to say, Sue is a friend of mine, but if you buy one book about autism, buy this one, the Fletcher Watson and Happay book called Autism, which is available in the library as an ebook, and is the set book for my final year option on autism. Anyway, so thank you very much. Time for questions.
Okay, so we've had a few questions come through, so I'm just going to try and do them in order.
Okay.
So we have Gordon, who has asked, is it time for the DSM-5 to be updated with criteria more explicitly influenced by sensory processing, especially in the context of late diagnosis?
I suppose. I mean, the thing is that the updating of the DSM-5 is a long and arduous process. It's probably going on as we speak. Curiously, in the ICD-11, which is the update of the World Health Organization diagnostic criteria, they've taken out the section about sensory issues. And you see, there is a sort of a problem with having them in the diagnostic criteria, which is that unless they're very well specified, it doesn't help you to distinguish autism from other conditions, because there are other conditions in which you get, as I've shown, other conditions in which you get sensory issues as well. So it's not necessarily something that makes autism distinctive, although I think probably it does if you look in more detail. And what some of the research we're doing is really trying to say, well, what's distinctive about the autistic sensory issues as opposed to those that you get in other types of neurodivergence? So I think certainly it's something that should be considered, but maybe the research isn't there to bolster it. And I think what diagnosticians want to do is maybe take it out so it doesn't confuse things, rather than keep it in and just have it as an associated condition rather than part of the diagnostic criteria. But at the moment, under DSM-5, it is part of the autism. It's a core feature of autism rather than just an adjunct.
Okay, thank you. We just had someone just comment in that they feel a crisp dust, glitter, dust and fabric seating very uncomfortable, but lots of people don't talk about it, and small particles being irritating. So that was just a comment there.
Right, yeah. That has come up in some of our research.
And then someone has written, so Anthony's written, WRT, the colour filters, is there any assays to determine its efficiency for the individuals? And if so, what colour might be the most effective?
That's the colour varies between individuals, and that's the important point about it. You can't just say, oh, I'll get a blue pair and that will work. You have to have it individually adjusted for you, and it's different in everyone. So use something for that called an intuitive colorimeter. And they do clinics on that at Glasgow Caledonian University in the optometry school. I think they still do. They have an intuitive colorimeter there, and they can work on that with you. I mean, it is the case that it's a very controversial thing. And in fact, a therapist based in Scotland was struck off recently for optometrist register for, well, he wasn't an optometrist actually, optician's register, I think it was. And he was prescribing these coloured filters for people, although not using the technique that's used at Caledonian. So it's very controversial, but I have to say that in the research that we've done, there seems to be some benefit, and that many autistic people swear by their coloured lenses. I think that possibly the effects wear off over time as well with those. But yeah, you can't just say this colour will work. These different colours work for different people.
Okay, thank you. We have a comment and a question from Amy in the chat.
Mm-hmm.
So she said, just to add, autistic burnout is not just related to sensory overload. Autistic burnout can occur as a result of high levels of stress, high expectations, social expectations, unable to take a break from all the above, and masking, all very common within higher education. Furthermore, burnout is often a final slash extreme physical and mental response to all of these things, and it can take a long time to recover. It is better to identify early signs of potential burnout than to wait, allow it to happen. So I guess a question more general to this is, what can be done by higher education to help prevent autistic and general burnout in higher education?
Well, that's a great question, Amy. As you know, I don't really have the full answer to that. I think obviously the sensory factors are a feature in burnout, largely causing higher stress levels. So I think maybe using some of those management techniques that I suggested, it'd be interesting to know how those work in practice. And to be honest with you, I only really thought of those yesterday. But it'd be interesting to map that onto the research that's already been done in higher education environments. And in particular, see if those techniques work for people. I mean, it's sort of anecdotally, I think they do. And there's one particular case of an autistic advocate I was talking to once, who was talking about the particular seat in the particular coffee shop that was her haven, if you like. But actually it ended up being a source of stress for her as well, because she was very keen to get that particular seat in that particular shop. And if somebody else was there, you know, it could be awkward. So I think you need to have several havens. If you're talking about a campus environment, you need to have several havens, as well as ideally, of course, your home environment would always be a haven as well. But anything we can do to reduce stress should reduce the chances of burnout, I guess. But it really depends on the individual. Must emphasize lots and lots of individual variation in these sensory features. So it's very hard to have a one size fits all, one rule fits all thing. So I think it's the sort of flexibility, a flexible approach is what we need, an individual adaptation.
Okay, thank you. Natalie's had her hand up for quite some time. Would you like to say?
Yes, please. Hi, David.
Hello.
Thank you very much for the talk. Would you be able to put up your slide with the that graph that you had that had adaptations for the individual?
Yes. Let me just do that. Sorry, I've got to.
That's okay. It's just to help me
just find it. So the one that I said my advice or something like that, or
I think it was the end, and above that one there, that, see that number 42,
this one. Yes, okay.
So one of my concerns, so I am an autistic student at the University of Glasgow, and I was previously an autistic staff member at the University of Edinburgh. And one of my concerns from this slide is that I don't want people in the audience to think that what you're saying here is it's completely down to the autistic individual to make these things happen.
Ah, right. Yes, of course.
What you're saying, but I think it could be interpreted that way. And it's and it's not. And there are tools that you can use to identify things that you can do with your supervisor. I just don't want supervisors on the call to see that and think, oh good, your problem, go away.
And no, absolutely not. Now this data was taken from a survey that we did, and it was just asking people what they did do. It's not necessarily recommending what to do. But in that case, people were avoiding and using self-soothing. But as I said, avoidance isn't necessarily a good strategy all the time, although it does work. So in extreme cases, then you do have to do that.
So I don't know if Universal have something in place already, but Sue Fletcher Watson, the author of the book you mentioned, I wrote, we developed a tool that you can use in higher education settings so that you can have these conversations with your supervisor or your staff member with autism and identify what could help.
Right. And that focuses on sensory things, does it, as well?
It can include sensory things as well. So for us, they were any adaptation that you would need in the workplace. And often they were sensory changes that you would make. But it's a good tool to use to have that conversation with someone so that they also know that it's not 100% the responsibility. Yeah.
Is that publicly available?
Yeah, it is. I can send you it if you like.
Yeah, if you would, then we can add it to the materials that when we put this online, we can add it to the materials. So it'd be great to have that there.
Because often the autistic individual...
I think I saw you talk about it.
sometimes the autistic individual won't notice that actually they were having a sensory issue.
Yeah.
I actually didn't know that I didn't like grids until you put up those pictures.
Oh, so, yeah, I should have given you that content warning, shouldn't I?
No, it's okay.
Sorry about that.
Picture of an escalator on there, and I've always hated escalators.
Yeah.
And I've always had trouble in supermarkets looking on the shelves, and I didn't know that that could possibly be because I don't like grid structures.
Yeah.
And I've learned from seeing somebody else say it, so... Yeah, sometimes people don't know what their sensory issues are until somebody else points out that maybe that could be something. So it's a good tool.
Yeah, well, I also think actually it's good to, I know this is blowing my own trumpet to a certain extent, but it's good to get involved in research because by getting involved in the research, you'll learn about these things yourself. And we do have the Glasgow Sensory Questionnaire, you know, if you want to fill it in. It might give you an idea of what the issues specifically are for you as well. So, and that just highlights some of the more common features that autistic people tend to show, but also others as well, as I've pointed out.
Thanks, David.
Thank you.
Okay, so we have around 4 or 5 other questions left. So if people would like to stay on, obviously still stay on, but you'll have the recording as well of this. So if you do need to make a move, I understand, but I'll just ask the questions. So I think this one has already been answered, but Janice says, would that mean that someone could be diagnosed with sensory processing disorder as well as autism?
Yeah, well, it's interesting. Sensory processing disorder isn't an official diagnostic thing under the World Health Organization or under the American Psychiatric Association, but it is a diagnosis that some people will give you. And so that's the idea of, just that sensory stuff without an associated other diagnosis, you know, autism or ADHD or anything else. So some people will give you that, but it's not official in the sense that it isn't sponsored by, as far as I know, any official body, like the NHS in particular. But, I mean, obviously anything to do with vision, it's good to see an optometrist. They should know about these things. If it's to do with audition, then an audiologist. So you do have specialists in those areas, I guess less so for the chemical senses, smell and taste. A lot of people, of course, have experienced anosmia and dysnosmia because of COVID, because it comes along with COVID. And there's some interesting aspects to that I've been learning about recently.
Okay, thank you for that. Natalie, would you mind popping the link in the... Oh, you can't find the link.
You can't find it.
Oh, you didn't find it. Thank you. Never mind.
David. And then maybe he can circulate it to everyone.
Yeah, that's
brilliant, Natalie. Yeah, that would be fantastic. This is one of the reasons we're doing this, is to pick these things up from outside. I should have known about that already, but I just... In the rush to prepare for this, I hadn't picked it up, but thank you.
Institutions, I think it's only maybe University of Edinburgh, and I think Plymouth University picked it up.
Well, we're very happy to do it too, I think. Well, we are, but persuading other people to take it on is another matter, but we'll definitely pick it up.
So we have a question here saying, is there any research on reasonable adaptation in school environments that go beyond the perspective of students? As a teacher on the autistic spectrum, I really struggle with the sensory aspects of the school day.
Well, funnily enough, I just examined a PhD at Durham University, which was all about school environments. We've done some research on school environments as well. Of course, you're right in that it does tend to focus on the children rather than the teachers. Although informally, I certainly noticed that when we were doing our research in primary schools, that many teachers had various sensory sensitivities, not necessarily autistic diagnoses, but definitely sensory sensitivities. But that's a very good point about the work environment. That would be an interesting project. So, and I'm certainly working with people in the School of Education on things like inclusion. That would be a really interesting thing to do. I'm not aware offhand of any research, although obviously the ideas I've talked about today should help. Although I imagine it's difficult, especially maybe in a primary school environment, it'd be very difficult to control noise levels in a room full of primary school kids. Well, I mean, I guess it's also true in secondary schools, but a lot of the same things will apply, but there will be some differences to do with the level of control you can exert, I think.
Okay, thank you. What can you do if your employer or school is unwilling to make adaptations?
That can be difficult. It's often commented that whilst, inflexibility is supposed to be a feature of autism, it's incredible how inflexible neurotypical people can be. To give you a case in point, there's somebody I know very well, who was trying to get the timing of a fire alarm test moved so that it didn't interfere with his college day. And that took a large number of letters and phone calls and things like that to do. And there's no particular reason why it had to be at one time rather than another time. So obviously there are things that can't be adjusted, like the weather. And it's difficult, you know, like we talked about in the school environment with young children, those are really difficult to control. Now, it seemed to me that if you're talking about changes in lighting, in decor, in noise levels, then things could be done and reasonably cheaply. But I mean, I guess it's all about the definition of the word reasonable. I've been somewhat impressed by the new teaching hub building, the James McKeon Smith building, in that the noise levels in there seem to be quite low, even if it's busy. And I think maybe something to do with the acoustic structure is working rather well in there. But I don't know if anybody else has a feeling about that. Whereas the old Fraser building was maybe a little bit more noisy and clattery in the way that I spoke about in the talk. Yeah, they have to do reasonable adjustments, but it's what is reasonable, Dustin, I think, can be the issue.
Thank you. Sorry, I missed a question in the chat as well, saying, is there a possibility that emotional overload of autism is related to the individual's overinterpretation of the external information?
So if I'm interpreting you correctly, you mean that by focusing a lot on the sensory environment, you are making yourself upset? Is that what the sort of thing you mean? And I guess that could be, yeah, that could be, I mean, certainly some clinicians have argued to me that the focus on sensory issues in autism is because it's something very tangible that you can put your finger on as an explanation for your anxiety, whereas maybe there's a more complex explanation than that. But so whether it's chicken or egg is difficult to know. We're quite interested in how it manifests in children as well. And some of our evidence suggests that quite a lot of young children have sensory sensitivities, and they tend to diminish as they neurotypical children, these diminish as they get older. And what the reasons are behind that, why they don't diminish in autistic children, is something that we're really interested in looking at. It might be something to do with motivations to get involved in social activity. And that if you have those motivations, that you somehow learn to modulate the sensory difficulties. To give you a case in point, if you've ever tried, you know, if you go to a bar in the evening, then often you'll get really loud noise in that, but people seem to tolerate it. When you get to my age, you're less tolerant of it, but people seem to tolerate it because they're so interested in getting that social interaction that you can get in that bar environment. But what is it that motivates people to go through really unpleasant sensory experiences when others won't? I haven't really answered your question very well, but I've waffled around the subject, so hopefully that's okay.
I'm going to answer four more questions and then we'll finish up so that we're not here forever. What do we do when we encounter a person who may be autistic but is undiagnosed? How do we approach such situations?
Well, I think the question is to talk to them. Well, it's difficult. It's difficult, I think, because some people aren't interested and don't want to be labelled, and others it might be a revelation. Now, certainly if you look at the Smith and Sharp paper, the participants in that study talked about the diagnosis being a really useful thing, because that explained behaviours and things that happened to them that they couldn't otherwise explain. And obviously also with an official diagnosis, you have a greater chance of getting access to services, although it doesn't necessarily mean you will, but at least you have a greater chance with that diagnosis. So I think on the whole, it's a positive thing, but not everybody wants to fit into that label. Not everybody wants to go through that process. So it's really, it's up to an individual. All you can do, I think, is inform and make sure people know what autism is, and especially, these sensory things, as Natalie said, that you might be unaware of. Synesthesia, for example, is one of those things that often people aren't aware that they have. They think everybody sees Thursday as yellow, and they've always seen Thursday as yellow for their entire life, and don't understand that other people don't. So there are things like that might be occurring, but you can't really force it on somebody. It's up to them to take their own steps in that diagnostic path. But I think on balance, it's probably worth it. I think that's what the research would say, but you know, that doesn't necessarily mean you have to tell your employer though, because it's very unclear whether that's a good thing or a bad thing.
Okay, thank you. Sarah popped in the chat, just said, can you also share the Glasgow sensory questionnaire? So
they well, we don't put it out in public, but if you send me an email, I can send it, a copy to you.
Okay. Another question. So could universities do more to encourage autistic school children to apply, especially if they might fear sensory overload? Schools often have havens, and it could be helpful to advertise that they can be found in universities too.
Yes, I think they could. I think possibly as you're part of the various sort of neurodiversity projects going on, we should look at encouraging autistic students to apply. I'm not sure that we do enough on that at the moment. And as is clear from my final slides, I think we're hugely missing out. We're letting them down, and we're letting the university down in a sense, because there's lots of talent out there that's been that's not being developed in the way that it should be. So I think we could do a lot more, yes.
Okay.
I don't really have an answer, but.
I think it's a tricky question, isn't it?
Yeah, there is I'm just remembering there's that study, that Bath University thing, where they had a special course for people who wanted to go to university, a sort of taster course, that seemed a very useful thing. We'll on the materials, let's try and find a link to that, Lee, and put it on the materials. Yeah, Bath University. This guy called Mark Brosnan, Professor Mark Brosnan at Bath University, with some others, was running a course. I think, was it an Autism Journal Club or something like that? Not sure.
Yeah, familiar feeling. Yeah, I'll write it down and we'll disseminate that as well. And then one final question, last question. How much research weight should be given to strategies relating to assimilating the autistic person to better cope with the environment versus wider political and structural work relating to dismantling, disabling barriers and making the world/society more autistic friendly? I'll read it again because it's quite a long.
No, I get the point. It's you're really saying how much should we try to adapt the individual and how much should we try to adapt the university? I think, as I pointed out, the issue is there are aspects of the real world that you just can't change because it's to do with the weather, and other ways in which society is organised, which is a bigger thing to change than the environment in an institution like the University of Glasgow. So I think we should look at both things because of the things that you can't change. Helping people to cope with those real world sensory stresses is useful, but it isn't something that's going to solve every problem, and there should be environmental adjustments as well. So I think it's a balance between helping people cope on an individual level and also the institution or whatever power structures are around that can influence the environment being more friendly and being more flexible when it comes to these changes. I hope that's answered your question.
Okay, does anyone have any final thoughts or questions? You can raise your hand or pop it in the chat, but if not, we'll probably log off at 20 past.
You're saving the chat, Lee, are you, for future
reference? Yeah, everything gets saved, yeah, everything.
Great.
Saved. So
that's good. Mm-hmm. Right, thank you very much, Lee, for organising this.
Thank you everyone for coming. Thanks, David. Thank you.